Hello, meat folks. Welcome to the Meat Pod Podcast. My name is Francisco Nohar. I'm your host today. I'm very excited and very happy because in this episode, we have a very good friend. He does a lot of animal welfare work, a lot of harvesting, processing at the university. And I think for the purpose of this podcast, he was a really good person to talk about some of the questions from our meat processors talking about stunning. Why is stunning important to make it more efficient in our meat facilities and physically more specifically looking at small and mid-sized meat processors? But it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Kurt Vogel. Welcome, Dr. Vogel. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Thank you very much for letting me join you today, Francisco.
No, it's a pleasure to have you on. We're discussing earlier about how Dr. Bass, and we've been trying to do and interview a lot of meat scientists talking about really hot topics that are going on right now in the meat industry. But before we start this conversation, please tell us a little bit about your background, a little bit about your career, and how is it that you are teaching, and how's that with you right now, especially with all COVID stuff? I know you teaching a lot of it virtual, in person. Welcome again and take it away.
So I started out in dairy, actually. I grew up on a dairy farm in Southwest Wisconsin, and I didn't have a lot of deep exposure to the meat industry other than visiting the local processing and butcher shop where we would take cattle to be processed every year or so for use at home. I did my undergrad at UW-Madison, at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I started working in their meat processing facility, in their meat lab. And at around the similar time, I also got a job with Cargill Regional Beef when they had a slaughter facility that was open in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. So those were really my first two major exposures to meat processing and slaughter in particular. I've always had a really strong interest in the quality of cull cows and in animal welfare and humane slaughter. And so those things all fit together at that Cargill facility. And that's where I really cut my teeth and learned a lot about industry. And then from there, I was fortunate to meet Dr. Temple Grandin. As a matter of fact, I was working in that Cargill plant and was introduced to Dr. Grandin by their general manager, Jerry Karshevsky. Right. And so that's how I found my way more into graduate school. Dr. Grandin invited me to do a PhD with her. My wife and I thought this is a once in a lifetime opportunity. So we packed up and we went to Colorado to do the PhD. After I was finished at Colorado State, or really close to finishing up at Colorado State, there was a position that opened at the University of Wisconsin River Falls. That was focused on animal welfare. So I applied for that position and I was really fortunate to land that. I really wanted that job. And the reason I wanted that one so badly is because it was highly focused on teaching, but they had some really nice facilities to work in too. So it fit me really well. So I started at UW River Falls in January of 2011, and I've been there since. And so I teach courses that are focused on animal welfare, specifically my area of expertise is farm animal welfare. And then I also jump in and sort of pinch hit in meat and meat products and also in animal physiology as well. We do a little bit of research too. We have an undergraduate research lab that we call the Animal Welfare Lab at UW River Falls. And we usually have around a dozen undergraduate students that are working on a variety of research projects in that space. So that's a little bit about what we're up to.
Awesome. And how is working under Dr. Grandin? You know, she is an amazing professor. She does a lot of work on animal welfare. How is that experience? I'm real jealous, honestly, to be working under her.
Oh, yeah, that was incredible. I think if I were going to point to one person that had the biggest impact on my life overall, it would be her. And it was fortunate that she found me working in some old coal cow slaughter facility. You know, it's amazing the way life works out. But when I was working with her, one thing that I think made it work really well is that we have a similar set of interests in the humane handling and stunning of animals around slaughter. And it's not like that's one of those topics you like go out and use as an icebreaker when you're meeting people for the first time. You know, you're not going to like walk up to them and be like, "Hey, have you ever seen the Jarvis USSS-21? It's a great stunner." Because most people are going to be like, "You are weird. Get away from me." Right. But in Temple's case, it fit really well because we were both really into that stuff. You know, we were passionate about trying to make sure that animals don't suffer in the final moments of their lives. So it fits, you know. So when I was working with her, there was one really important thing that I learned. I learned tons of stuff, but one really important piece that I share with my students is this concept that she shared called project loyalty. And she described it like this, that project loyalty is that thing that will get you through a really hard time when you have a job that needs to be done. So you're in grad school right now. You'll run into this if you haven't run into it already, where there's some sort of hardship that comes up. There's a piece of your project that doesn't go well, right? Or there's some sort of interpersonal conflict or whatever. And the moral of that concept is that you stay focused on the goal instead of being pulled off in other directions by distractions that come up. Yeah. Right. You stay loyal to the project. So that's something that I took from her that I try to share with other people because it's just, I don't know. It had a big impact on how I try to do things.
Yeah. No, and I think you really bring a very good point in terms of failure, because sometimes as long as we want to make our best to make it perfect, it doesn't exist. I mean, there's something that is going to occur along the way that is not going to make it perfect. But I think in my mind, I prefer progress than perfection. I don't know what you think about that, but I think this is really along those lines. But again, going back to a lot of your work in animal welfare, you do a lot of research on stunning times, stunning processes, and we're talking about some of how we work on hogs and how we do electrical stunning on hogs. But before we start into that very more in depth, would you please tell us about the importance of having an efficient stunning process in our meat facility?
Yeah, for sure. So I think we can talk a little bit about the Humane Slaughter Act for a moment, because that's kind of it's a central piece in this. So there's like an ethical piece, and then there's this obligatory piece where you have to follow the law. And then in addition to that, there are other benefits that we find from providing pre-slaughter stunning that affect meat quality. So we have like these three pieces that are lined up. So we'll focus on the law first. So the Humane Slaughter Act was passed in 1958. It was put into effect in 1960. It applied to slaughter establishments that were federally inspected and sold meat to the U.S. government to start off with. And then later on, it was amended in 1978 to include all federally inspected slaughter facilities. So by default, it included state inspected facilities too, because they have equal to standards between the two inspection systems. So the reason I bring up that law is because in that law, they gave the rationale for why that law existed. And it was focused on improving the economy of meat processing. So like the efficiency and how fast and how smoothly things could run. It also was used to improve product quality, to prevent needless animal suffering, and to protect the safety of workers. And so even from the original inception of that law, we've already got the four main pieces laid out there of why pre-slaughter stunning and humane slaughter matters. So that's really the core of it, right? If we have an efficient stunning system in place, then we're going to prevent needless suffering for the animals. The system's going to run smoother and more predictably. We should have a more consistent product overall. And so our plant should run more efficiently. Now, the other piece to this too, and it's a piece that we haven't focused on as much, is that having an efficient and effective stunning system in place probably has a positive effect for the mental well-being of the people that are doing the job too. At the end of the day, you got to remember that the slaughter process involves ending a life. And so most people have enough empathy that it will get to them if that process is messed up. And so that's where it's really important to make sure that this is done right and done consistently.
Awesome. No, I think you really share a really very good insight in terms of, we typically will focus on, oh yeah, we want to make it the most humane possible, mainly possible, but also there's a lot into that. And you mentioned empathy, and that's a very good insight, because it's going to get you. I mean, if the animal's suffering, so there's sometimes there are places, not only here in the US, but in the country, that they don't have the actual tools to do it humanely. And that's something that really happened in a smaller and larger scale, that's something that it's very important to have. Just talk a little bit, if you will, on kind of the types of stunning. I know in cattle, we use captive bolt. And on hogs, we try to do electrical stunning. And if we can do like the CO2 or the chemical stunning, would you please tell us, and just as an overview, talk a little bit about those, and then we can start more in depth about your project.
Yeah, sure. So there are three primary categories of stunning that we acknowledge. So we have chemical, physical, and electrical. The chemical method, like you mentioned, is typically carbon dioxide gas. And for the most part, in red meat species, we see that used on pigs. In poultry, though, we see it used quite a bit for chickens and turkeys. We also will see physical stunning used. And the thing about physical stunning, that's going to include captive bolt or gunshot. We also refer to it as mechanical stunning. So that type of stunning method can be applied to any species. That's kind of the nice thing about using that method. It's quick, it's effective. One of the big issues that we run into with it, though, is that in some species, there's a considerable amount of post-stun involuntary carcass movement that makes it really hard for shackling. That's one of the main reasons why, for a lot of small and very small processors that use captive bolt guns, we'll often try to transition them off of using captive bolt onto using electrical stunning if they have effective restraint available, just because it's so hard to get those pigs shackled. And there's also a fair amount of petechial hemorrhaging that'll happen as well, just from all of the change in blood pressure that happens with the very rapid and massive amount of muscle contraction that happens after a captive bolt stun on a pig. And then the third category is electrical stunning, and that one's pretty straightforward. So in that case, we're going to apply an electrical current to the body of the animal. It has to include the brain in the circuit. So this can either be done with a single step, where we're going to pass a current just across the brain. In that case, we're going to usually have a window of about 15 seconds that we have to have the animal hoisted and stuck. So bleeding has to start, or there's a good chance the animal's going to return to consciousness. We can also include part of the spinal column in that circuit too. And that's what you see in a lot of larger plants that do electrical stunning. So they usually have an electrode that's near the head and another electrode that's located further back on the body. And with that type of stunning system, the thought is that it's going to knock out the brain, but then also depolarize that section of the spine that's included in the circuit. And that also helps then to make it so that the heart doesn't function as it normally would. So it goes into this state of fibrillation where it's just beating so erratically and irregularly that you can't pump blood consistently through the body. The other process, or the other approach that we can take with electrical stunning, is we can do a two-step process. So we can apply electrical current across the head, roll the animal out of a restrainer if we need to, or let the animal collapse depending on how we're stunning, and then apply a current to the cardiac region, so at the heart, to knock out the heart too. So that gives you a little bit of a description of some of the stunning that we use.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you brought up a very good point in terms of if that facility has the ability to have very that restraint in place. You mentioned for that electrical stunning, when you go from back on the head to all the way to the right on the back, further back on the body. We do a lot of maybe four or five times a semester here at K-State when we slaughter pigs, and that's a method that we utilize here. And you mentioned that because not a lot of people have that ability to have that in place, in terms of that the pig cannot move to get that very efficiently applied, the electricity going through that. So I think that's a pretty good point. And I think some of the challenges, right? And you mentioned the captive bolt, it's efficient, but you have that involuntary movement, but that doesn't mean the animal is conscious. It's just, right? That, but that sometimes freaks people out because, hey, is that really, is that kicking a lot? Is that really stun, or what do you do? So, do you have any thoughts on that? Like that kicking, what type of, recommendations real quick for folks that are having that issue, that they're right, doing it right, but they see a lot of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that one's really tough. So if, in the case of cattle, we can usually manage it pretty well because you have kind of a window where there's not a lot of movement after the stun. And as long as you're working within that period of time, you can get a shackle on and you can get hoisting pretty quickly. But in the case of pigs, it's usually best to try to use some other type of stunning method if you can. Or you might have to either table stick, which is not necessarily the best route to take because it really takes relearning the motion of exsanguination, because it's different if the animal's lying on its side versus hanging upside down, but it's something that can be learned. So that's an option. Another choice is to try to knock out the heart, and then you've got hopefully enough depolarization of the spine that goes along with that stun that you'll have a little longer time to get that shackle on before the animal starts to kick. In general, though, we want to try to avoid using a captive bolt or a gunshot on pigs just because of all that involuntary kicking and the carcass damage that comes along with it. With that said, you have carcass damage with electrical stunning on pigs too, because that's where you're usually going to see breakage of bones and also, blood splash there as well. So, there's no real silver bullet there. Another thing we've got to kind of think about here in the future is how the pigs experience carbon dioxide stunning too. So it seems that there is a portion of the population of pigs that respond adversely to exposure to carbon dioxide. And so that's one of those challenges we've got to get our heads wrapped around, I think, pretty soon, and try to fix the issue. It seems like that's an issue that might be able to be fixed through genetic selection of pigs that just they don't respond adversely to carbon dioxide, but it's going to take some work to figure it out.
Yeah, and what do you mean by adversely? You mean that the livestock won't get knocked, or what do you mean by that?
So, what I mean is that they'll respond adversely, meaning that they'll become agitated or excited and may display behaviors that look like escape behaviors inside the gondola when they're going into the CO2 system. Mm-hmm.
So I know, generally speaking, when we think about CO2 chambers, we think that the quality is improved overall. Is that an accurate statement? When you compare electrical stunning versus CO2 stunning or chemical stunning?
Oh yeah, yeah. The color is better in CO2 stunned pigs, and you'll see far less blood splash. Blood splash is very uncommon in CO2 systems, and also bone breaks. So you don't see as much of that either. So the movement to CO2 has done a lot for improving meat quality. And the next challenge we have to focus on is making sure that the pigs that we're putting into those systems don't experience discomfort within those systems.
I agree. Maybe in a future episode, we can talk more about all that. And I'm sure there's going to be a lot of more research going on to address those questions. And I think we're wrapping up this conversation. I started doing this maybe five episodes before. Just before with Dr. Calkins. The intent is to give us some insight on your personal experience, that what got you there. I don't know if you can, so our audience can get to know you, who's Dr. Vogel. Tell us, right off the bat, any experience that really you went through that helped you become a better professional, professionally and emotionally, that I can be related to meat science or not, but something that, anything you think of. I mean, you mentioned Dr. Granding, that was a very good experience, right? That really changed, and that I don't know if you have something in mind, and then we can continue with the last question on.
Yeah, this is a good question, Francisco. The one I've got to share. So one thing I've kind of come to learn is that the lessons that we learn that stick with us the longest typically are rooted in failure. And so in my case, I think the experience that really changed the way that I approach how I live and what I prioritize had to do with one job in particular that I really wanted, applied for, interviewed for, and just failed to secure. And I think that really had an impact on how I approached how I do things, because there's nothing more humbling than coming up short on something you really, really want. And at that point, it forces you to reassess what matters to you. And so at that point, once I could move past the original kind of the sting of missing that opportunity, then the next thing I had to do was take a look at what I had left and reassess what success meant for me. And so at that point, I realized that I was pretty successful already with what I had. I'm fortunate. I've got, I'm in a position where I get to mentor people for a living. I identify as a teacher first. And so I'm really happy with the role that I'm in, because all I get to do is I get to teach and help people succeed. It's cool. And then in addition to that, I'm fortunate that I'm in a role right now where I get to spend time with my family. And what's really interesting about all this, at least for me, is that this whole experience with COVID and working from home has granted me more time to spend with my family. Now, with that said, it's not all just hanging out, right? And lounging around all the time, because we also chose to homeschool our two boys. And so what I'm doing right now is I'm teaching during the day my kids, and then I'm teaching my students during the night. So that's when I'm building lecture content, posting stuff, right? And so you're burning the candle at both ends. It's not sustainable, but I think that I'll be able to look back on this and feel pretty good about what was accomplished. That's the wild thing about it all is when you're in the thick of it all, you don't have those good feelings of nostalgia and getting the job done yet. But one thing to keep in mind is that when things are really tough and it feels like it's really hard, it's going to feel really good to turn around and take a look once you're through it.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. I think that's something that I think a lot of our audience can relate to that. And students that are listening to this, I hope that if someone is going through a rough situation, meaning that they didn't get that job, meaning that they failed, I see a lot of people that, hey, I got a B on this class. I always get an A. And it was like, well, it's not the end of the world. I mean, you what do you get a B? I mean, you got to learn why you did that. But also, a lot of the things are measured off of your person. I mean, with the tools that you have, and sometimes those tools are not great, right? I mean, how hardworking you are, how consistent you are, how disciplined you are. I mean, those things that they're not tangible. I think most of the time is more important than saying I got an A on this class on an A on that class. I think those things in my mind, I don't know what you think, they speak more to what you really are as a person in terms of just all academia and grades and classes.
I think you're right on. I'm glad that this is a point that your listeners are going to get to hear, especially for those folks that are really getting started. It's not all about the number of papers you publish, although that's a metric that we use quite a bit in academia, right? For like a measure of success. So we've got to make sure that we're at least clearing that hurdle if we want to pursue a career in academia. But the other piece to it too is we've got to make sure that we find these ways that we can find intrinsic value in ourselves, right? Like what's the value that we bring to the world? And the second piece to it too, that I really want to share here is that there's this saying that I always keep in the back of my mind, because it's not like it was just that one experience that I shared with you that's been a challenge, right? So I was talking with a good mentor of mine just a while back, and he said, man, if I paid attention to all the failures that I had, I wouldn't see all the success I had. And I think that's important to keep in mind. You know, for all those successes, there are plenty of failures, plenty of times you come up short. And one thing I always tell myself when I'm coming up short with something is that this is just a cloud, and the sun's going to shine once that cloud passes. And sure enough, it does.
Well, thank you for sharing that again. And we're wrapping up this conversation with one last question. And this is more related to your actual research that you're conducting on. You mentioned head and heart stunning. Please tell us a little bit about this research and a little bit about the importance of this research and some of the results and implications of the data you guys found.
Yeah, this is an older study that we did. So back in, I think we published this one in like 2010 or 2012 or so. But anyway, the project has probably been the most impactful work I've been a part of. So what really spurred us on here, got us started, was that we were hearing reports from small and very small slaughter establishments of pigs that were returning to consciousness during the bleed out period. So they'd be stunned and they'd be hoisted and they're bleeding and they're clearly returning to consciousness. They're showing writing reflexes and vocalizing and looking around, and it was not good. And so we thought, let's see if we can figure out a way to fix this before it becomes a really big visual issue, right? And at that same time, I ran across a good friend named Erica Vogel. And Erica is somebody that does a lot of animal welfare related work. She's a consultant, and she's spent a lot of her career working with Temple. So they have a very similar view on things in general. And Erica had been telling a lot of her consulting clients for quite some time that after they head only stun, they should apply another stun to the heart area of the pig, and that should knock out the heart and give them more time to hoist and to bleed. So there wasn't any validation work on that yet. So we designed a validation study and tested it out. What we found was that it worked in over 80% of the pigs that we applied the second heart stun to. We were able to knock out the heart. We couldn't find a detectable heartbeat. So we figured that was a successful thing. We also found that the effects on meat quality were fairly minimal. And I think part of that was because the effects on meat quality were masked by the fact that it was a small plant that couldn't get the pigs to the cooler that fast anyway. So, you know, if I were going to tell you that it had no effect at all on quality, I think I'd be lying, because there'd have to be an effect. You're applying a high amount of electrical energy to the carcass. You know, it's going to cause some damage to the carcass. So we published that work. And after we published that work, we learned that there were a lot of plants, small and very small plants, originally in the Upper Great Lakes region, but it sort of branched out more from there, that were picking up this method of electrical stunning for their pigs. I think it's pretty common now. And it's affected a lot of pigs and a lot of people. So that's one project in particular that was pretty cool to be a part of.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but when you mentioned the second stunning, so you stun the head and then after that you stun the heart, would you just tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. So what we did is we had two treatments in that study. One treatment was a head only stun that was applied for 3 seconds. And we were using the typical red box Best and Donovan Model ES stunner that a lot of people have, with the fork type stunning wand. So we didn't have tongs, although usually I recommend that people use tongs now because they hold onto the pig's head better. So that's a voltage regulated stunner. So we had it set for an output that would give us somewhere around 2 amps of current when we took the resistance of the pig into consideration. And so this was usually somewhere around like 290 volts. is about where we were. So that was our, you could almost call it our control, because it was what the industry was using at that time.
Just the head.
Yeah, just head only. Then for our head heart treatment, we applied the same head only stun for 3 seconds. We followed that immediately with the application of the stunning wand to the area right behind the sort of the armpit of the pig, if pigs had armpits. So right over the heart for another 3 seconds. And then after that, you go right into shackling and hoisting and everything else. So it was just that little secondary step.
Okay.
So, yep, that was our head heart treatment.
Okay. Yeah, awesome. Because I know, for example, what we do here is we have the long stunning, the stunner, but then you have the heart in the head, and you get all those at the same time instead of one being first and the one being the secondary one. Do you think that's also kind of related to that, like getting the two of them? That's, would you say, totally different?
It's very similar.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just that the process that you're using is going to do it all in one step. So, you know, either way, you know, you're accomplishing the same objective there, and that's to try to fibrillate the heart, to get that heart to beat in a very arrhythmic manner.
This is amazing. Thank you a lot for your time. I think this 35 minutes of your time, it's going to help a lot of people in terms of maybe assess what they're doing. If they're having, after they stun, they do a lot of kicking. If they're doing just the hand only stunning, they're doing both. It's just going to help them, to give them the importance before, like, why is this important in terms of the human act that you mentioned at the very beginning, and then some of the actual tangible things that can help you understand why is this in place, and that how that can help you to improve quality, have less detrimental effects on the actual overall quality of livestock. Thank you, Dr. Vogel, again for your time. Really appreciate it. I hope we can see you sometime next year soon. We continue these conversations with the most brilliant meat scientists in the world.
Well, thank you, Francisco. It's been a real pleasure. I really enjoyed our conversation today.
Thank you.